Yeah. So proving irrationals, how can I prove irrationals is, it's one method is in mathematics proving a number is irrational is indirect method of proof. I will explain you some example like this. While you are starting from one place, that means if you take something like, you have to say me, when you go to right hand side, then you will get the destination. But one of us will not accept that and he will turn to left. So if you go somewhere else into the in the direction of left, he won't get his destination. Then he realizes that, so it is not the way to reach my destination, so that I have to turn right. This is nothing but indirect method of proof. So taking the first directly, if you want to go to your destination, you have to move to right hand side. But it is not, you are not obeying that. So you are doing the opposite to that statement. So go to right hand side, you will go to your destination. You will say that, no, I won't go to right hand side. That is opposite to your statement. So finally, you will get that your statement is false. What's the statement? Going to left, I will reach the destination. Contrary to the statement. So that's why finally I have to go to right hand side. This is called the method of indirect method of proof that we will apply here in proof of irrational numbers. So let us move on to that, how we can prove that irrational numbers as they are irrational. That is most important. So see here. So we'll go with proof of irrational numbers, which are a part of real numbers. So first one is show that root 2 is irrational. So we know already that we have given a general definition that square root of prime numbers is always irrational. So we'll prove now how root 2 is irrational. So see, first I will take that it is indirect method of proof. Now I assume that root 2 is rational. This is opposite to the statement given. Given statement is irrational and I am assuming that given statement is rational. That means I have taken contrary to the statement. I have assumed that when it is rational, it is very important that every rational number can be written in the form of P by Q. That what we have done in the first discussion. The P and Q should be coprimes. So that means that rational number is in its simplest form. That's more important. So where PQ are coprimes. Now root 2 can be written as P by Q. Now taking Q to left hand side, I will take that root 2 Q equal to P. Because as Q is dividing here, it multiplies. Now we'll go with squaring on both sides. So that I will get squaring on both sides, root 2 Q whole square gives us P square. Now 2 Q square gives us P square. That I have taken as one equation. So by this, I can say that 2 is a factor of P square. So what else I can say? After 2 is a factor of P square, what can I say? The next statement. Can anybody guess? If 2 is a factor of P square, then what happens? By the theorem, what we have learned previously? Yeah, Deshmika?
P square is multiple of 2.
Still? When 2 is a factor of P square, then what can you say the next statement? Swati?
Q is a factor of P.
Oh, come again, Swati?
Q is also a factor of P.
Q is also a factor of P. Yeah, Deshmika? Yeah?
That one only I want to say, sir.
Okay, and yes, Mohit.
2 divides P square, sir.
That means 2 is a factor of P square. Then? Yeah, Avinash.
4 can also divide P square, sir.
4 also can divide P square. That's okay. Rishin?
Root 2 is a factor of P, sir.
Root 2?
Yes, sir.
Where is root 2?
When we take that root, that side.
Okay. Rishin, okay. Some other, yeah, as Swati, Avinash, I have done all remaining who raised the hand. Yeah. Here, I will write one thing so that you will all understand. Is it that much easy? That is, 2 is a factor of P. That's we have done the previous theorem. When P divides A square, then P divides A. So when 2e, that I asked you, when P divides A square, we can say that P is a factor of A square. If P is a factor of A square, then P is a factor of A. So when 2 is a factor of P square, then 2 is a factor of P. Did you get this, all of you, now? You can show with your thumb. I'm repeating. Nothing is there into, yeah, nothing is there into worry here. When I write 2 is a factor of P square, by the theorem what I have learned previously, I have to apply that here. 2 is a factor of P. Whenever 2 is a factor of P, that there your friend mentioned that, immediately that P can be written as 2 into something, multiple of 2. Then I can write P equals to 2R. So now I will take squaring on both sides. Again, I will get P square equals to 2R whole square. You can ask me, sir, why should we square again? In first step, we have squared because to avoid the square root. But why we have to square on both sides here? Because I need P square. That's there in red ink what I have given here in the first equation. So I have done the squaring on both sides. Hence, I got P square equal to 4R square. Now I will substitute this 4R square in the place of P square in the first equation. Hence, I will get 2Q square equal to 4R square. So then simplifying this, I will write that I can divide 2 on both sides so that I will get Q square equal to 2R square. Can anybody guess what will be the next step? Yeah. Rushin, yeah, please.
Q is equals to root 2R.
Q is equal to root 2R. Good. Still anybody? Only Rushin, remaining all. I'm asking, what can be the next step? What can I write from that equation? What can I write from that equation? Nobody else? Yeah, Deshmita, yeah?
2 is a factor of Q square.
That's good, that's good. So 2 is a factor of Q square, I can write, because Q square has written as multiple of 2. Similarly, definitely I can write 2 is a factor of Q square. Then what will be the next step, Deshmukh?
2 is a factor of Q.
That's good. 2 is a factor of Q. So from this, what can you say, finally?
2 is factor of both P and Q.
Wonderful. 2 is a factor of, a common factor of P and Q. Because 2 is a factor of P already we have done, and 2 is a factor of Q already we have done, since 2 is common factor of P and Q. So what happens then if 2 is a common factor of P and Q? Can anybody assume that? What happens when 2 is a common factor of P and Q? P and Q 2 common factor, if any problem will like do? Do you have any problem? Yeah, to Jitendra, yeah, please.
You already told that P and Q are coprimes, but 2 is a factor of P and Q. How it is possible, sir?
Yes, this is the thing. Yes, Avinash also mentioning something. We will see. Yeah, Avinash?
Same, sir, same.
Same, very good, very good. So I have mentioned that P and Q are coprimes. Coprimes means they should not have any prime, any factors other than 1. But I have done now 2 is common factor of P and Q. So that I have done a mistake. What mistake I have done? This is absolutely contradiction, as P and Q are coprimes that you have mentioned. So why this contradiction arrived? Why this contradiction arrived? Because I have taken root 2 as P by Q. So if root 2 is P by Q, so I have taken root 2 as P by Q. Why I have taken root 2 as P by Q? Because I have assumed that root 2 is rational. When I assumed root 2 is rational, I got a contradiction here. So hence, I can say that my assumption is false. So whenever my assumption is false, what is my assumption? Root 2 is rational. Hence, the statement, given statement is right. Therefore, root 2 is irrational. See, this is very easiest proof, but where we have to mention each and every condition very clearly. I'm repeating the theorem again. Once you observe, show that root 2 is irrational. So we have to start with an indirect method of proof by starting assumption. So let us assume that root 2 is rational. I have to go with rational assumption. So whenever root 2 is irrational, I assumed, then immediately I can say that root 2 as p by q. And the most important, most generally, so many will miss this line. If you miss this line, you can't arrive that final answer. So how to go with where p and q are coprimes. So immediately I will take that q to left hand side so that I will get 2 root 2 q equal to p. Then we will go with squaring on both sides. So I will arrive with 2 q square equal to p square. This can be taken as first equation. Otherwise, we will have some confusion again. So immediately when I write 2 q square equal to p square, that means p square has written a multiple of 2. Hence, 2 is a factor of p square. So when 2 is a factor of p square, immediately by the theorem what I have learned previously, I can say that 2 is a factor of p. When a number is factor of another number, I can write that number as multiple of 2. So p is equals to 2 times r for some integer r. Again, I'm doing the squaring on both sides. Hence, I need p square in the first equation. So p square, I got 4r square. I substituted that p square in the first equation so that I arrived with 2q square equal to 4r square. By simplifying that, I got q square equal to 2r square. Finally, I can say that 2 is a factor of q square. So when 2 is a factor of q square, as we said previously, I can say that 2 is a factor of q. When 2 is a factor of q, when already we know that 2 is a factor of p, it arrives that 2 is a common factor of p and q, which contradicts our definition p, q are coprimes, our assumption. Since this is a conduction, definitely our assumption that root 2 can be written in the form of p by q is false, which leads us root 2 is rational is false, therefore root 2 is irrational. So dear students, did you understand clearly how to prove that a irrational number is irrational? Yeah. So do you have any doubts? Just we can discuss here. If you have any doubts. I think, yeah, you have to do how root 5 is irrational. You send me to my number. How root 5 is irrational. So you write the proof the same. So finally, I can say that in general, it can be shown that root d is irrational whenever d is a positive integer, which is not the square of an integer. Can anybody give an example for this? Yeah. Nadeshmika?
Root 3.
What?
Root 3.
Root 3.
Root 3.
Hmm.
Root 5.
Hmm.
Root 6.
Root 6?
Root 7.
How can you say that?
Root 8. Hello, sir.
How can we say that with this statement? How can you apply for those examples?
Because those numbers are not a square of any number, sir.
Square of. That means we can say that they are not perfect squares?
Yes, sir.
So, if the square root contains a non-perfect square, is it irrational?
Yes, sir.
Yes, Rushin want to mention something. Yeah, please, Rushin.
When the positive integer which is in a root, if it is not a perfect square, we can assume that as an irrational.
That's what. So see that you have arrived with a definition now. There are two types of definitions for irrationals. Irrationals, previously you mentioned that non-terminating, non-repeating decimals are irrationals. But it is not possible to say always to calculate what is the value of root 2, what's the value of root 3, what's the value of root 5. And we can't find the total number of decimals where it is repeating or non-repeating. generally, do you have that doubt in previous or not? I have that, but do you have that doubt previously or not? So how you can say root 2 is irrational? How you can say root 3 is irrational? Simply we will escape that. Root 2 cannot be written in the form of terminating or non-terminating recurring. It is non-terminating recurring, so that it is irrational. So if anybody asks what's the value of root 2, then you have to go for a division. Is it right? We'll go with 1.414 and so on. But no, we don't know whether it is repeating or non-repeating without doing division. We have the doubt. Now that doubt can be cleared off like this. How you can say when the square root is there, if d is a positive integer, if any positive integer, if it is a non-perfect square, then its square root can be taken as irrational numbers. Can all of you join with me for this? Yeah, only one? I think still remaining have some doubt. Only two? Two raised the hands? Okay. So it's not elections to vote. Okay. So yeah. So now onwards, whoever asks us how root 2 is irrational, you should not say that. We should not say that. It is non-terminating, non-repeating decimal. Hence, it is a irrational number. Although it is non-terminating, non-repeating decimal, but simply we can say that if a non-perfect square under square root is irrational. Now I'm asking, if a non-perfect cube under cube root is irrational? Yeah, this one, okay, root 6, root 8, root 15, root 24 are irrational numbers. That's you have done me. Now I'm asking, you have to find other cube root, fourth root, nth root. Nth root A, if it cannot be written in the form of A power N, is it irrational? You have to check it and you have to tell me. Yeah, Rishin, please.
Irrational, sir.
How can you say with an example?
Because, sir, when we take any cube, sir, 7 cube, 343.
7 cube, 343, yeah.
And cubes are there, no, sir. Other than those cubes, if you apply cube root, other than those cube, if you apply cube root, it is not possible, sir.
So, can I say cube root 16?
No, sir.
What is cube root 16? Is it rational or irrational?
Sir, actually, cube root 8 is 2, sir.
Cube root 8 is 2. So, is it rational or irrational?
Rational.
Cube root 8 is rational.
2. Rational.
So, cube root 16 is?
Cube root 16, sir.
So, cube root 16 is irrational or rational?
Just a minute, sir. 2 root 2, sir. Irrational.
It's irrational.
Yes, sir.
Think about that. You say me and I'm asking, is still square root of minus 2 and cube root of minus 8. These are the questions that you have to think. Whether these are rationals or irrationals, all of you. Whether it is rationals or irrationals. You give me some more examples like this. And one more question I have asked you. Prove root 5 is irrational. You do it and you send to me. And even these questions. Okay, students, good luck. It's almost all the time I have taken. I think it's okay for you. So can I